start exactly the same point where we also started yesterday. So this is the same slide that you saw yesterday, and somebody had asked me a question yesterday on whether in this whether it could not also happen that once microbes are confronted with environmental changes, whether every microbe would have to respond similarly. So this is going to be the topic of today's lecture. So question here, how would microbes adapt? Still the same one as yesterday. And also here, we look at this nutrient adaptation from E. coli adapting from glucose to acetate. And this is what I also showed you yesterday. So again, important is that there's a complete redirection of the carbon flow necessary. Well, and if we now would like to really experimentally study this adaptation here from growth on glucose to growth on acetate, well, then we could probably do a very, very simple experiment, an experiment that probably even theory people could do. And the experiment would go as follows. And we would grow cells in a shake flask. Now, this is typically how we would grow microorganisms. We would grow them on glucose. We would let them grow exponentially until they are fully adapted to glucose. And then we could take these cells out. We could spin them down in a centrifuge. We could wash these cells a couple of times. And then we could put them into the new environment. Yeah, very simple experiment. And what we could measure here in this new environment is, for instance, the number of cells in this culture as it develops over time. And the way we would do, we just measure the turbidity of this culture, and this is the optical density. And then if we would follow this optical density, so that would be corresponding to the number of cells as a function of time, what we get is we would get something like that looks like this. And that is something that you might have seen before. This is just the classical phases of any bacterial cell culture. There's a phase that is called the lag phase, where there's still apparently no growth or very little growth. And there's an acceleration phase, an exponential phase, and a deceleration phase. So this is something that you can find in every microbiology textbook. If you're now interested to understand of how E. coli would adapt between these two conditions, then it's probably this lag phase here that is most interesting to us, because this is probably where the adaptation would happen. So if you're now interested in that, then it's probably good if this concerns the lag phase, that we would go into the textbook and see what the textbooks write about the lag phase. So the first textbook that I consulted told me that the lag phase comes about because there's adaptation to novel condition will involve synthesis of new enzymes, which is something that would take time or so. Now that we're quantitative people, or at least we're supposed to want to be quantitative people, if you now benchmark the time that a lag phase here needs, yeah, that's about, say, 10 hours, and if you benchmark this time scale with our knowledge on how fast protein synthesis is in microorganisms, well, I should phrase this as a question, how fast is protein synthesis? What is the time scale of protein synthesis in microorganisms? Minutes to maybe 15 minutes, half an hour or so, something like this. Yeah? And if you now compare this time scale with this time scale here, you'll probably see that this doesn't really fit, right? Particularly that sometimes experimentalists have observed also lag phases that are much, much longer than these 10 hours. So there's a problem with time scale here, which could eventually indicate that this book here wasn't right. So maybe it's good to consult another book. And this book here says that the length of the lag phase is dependent on the size of the inoculum. And the inoculum is the number of cells that we throw in here. Yeah? And now it gets really obscure. Yeah? So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to cast doubts on what we know, what we think is the lag phase. And again, this is something that goes really back to the very early days of bacterial physiology. But still, it seems that our knowledge is incomplete. Well, so apparently the classical hypothesis, yeah, that would explain the lag phase here, that the necessary biochemical adaptations take time, have seen that this probably is not the right explanation. So what else could we come up with? And this is really something that we had, I think, started to look into in 2006 or so, that we ask, hey, could there not be a different explanation? And the alternative explanation that we came up with was that eventually only a fraction of cells would start to grow once they are put into the new environment, such that we would have here, this would be the logarithm of the number of cells versus time, so that we eventually would have a growing population that increases in number, exponentially, of course. And there would, and could it be that there's a population present that would not grow, yeah, that would stay constant in number? So if we would overlay these two curves, we would precisely get what we see on a population level as a lag phase. Okay, but the experiment that we're doing here, we're putting cells in here that are ideally isogenic, so they have the same genotype, if you do our experiment properly. These microorganisms are all in the same environment, but for this to be possible, it would need to be such that there's two distinct phenotypes present of the same genotype. And I guess the following slide I almost don't have to show anymore, but just to remind you, yes, there is something like stochasticity-induced phenotypic heterogeneity. That's when we started this, it was less common, but nowadays it's very well accepted. But just to remind you, there's two things that we are needing that we need for that. The one thing is that we need stochastic fluctuations of intracellular molecules, something that we call molecular noise, that comes about with proteins or with biomolecules that are very low in copy number. So if you take this example here, if this would be an E. coli cell, that would have 8 copies of this regulator. And these 8 copies would, of course, diffuse in the cell driven by Brownian motion. And now, if this cell divides, then it's probably not very unheard of that one of these cells could get just 3 copies, the other one had 5. And if you would be able to follow the copy numbers of such a cell as a function of time, we would see it tremendously fluctuating. Yeah? So this is something that is called molecular noise. It's just driven by Brownian motion and low copy number of molecules. But this is not yet sufficient to generate really distinct phenotypes. What we need for that is we need to have regulatory feedback architectures of this kind here. And I probably start explaining that first with this one here, where we have a loudspeaker and a microphone connected in this particular manner. And if you do this experiment saying hello here, probably nothing would happen. If I say hello a bit louder, yeah, then we would get this horrible noise going on. And even if I shut down, if I don't say anything anymore, this is still going on. And the biochemical version of this would be that this gene A would produce a protein A and in a non-linear fashion would activate its own expression. Yeah, so there's a positive feedback, and such molecular noise plus certain feedback regulation, what we could get is we could get multiple phenotypes of a clonal population, and clonal here means isogenic. Okay, so now going back to our question, well, where we'd like to discriminate between these two hypotheses. So we see that this in principle could be possible, yeah, according to this. But the question, is it really possible? Is this really the explanation for a lag phase? So what you had to do is, of course, we had to look into individual cells here, because it would be an explanation that we would require a single cell data. And what we now wanted to do is we wanted to actually know, when we do this experiment, would there be two different growth phenotypes? Yeah, would there be some cells growing according to this and some cells not growing according to this? And the assay that we came up with went the following way. So we took a fluorescent dye, and one that had such properties that it would intercalate into the membrane of a cell. So if you would now have an E. coli cell, and now we put a number of these dye molecules into this E. coli cell, and this E. coli cell would grow in length, and at some point it would divide. It's clear that there's there would not be any additional dye molecules coming. So what we would get is 1, 2, 3, 4, about 10, yeah? So meaning that each of these daughter cells would then just have 5 of these dye molecules, yeah? So with every division, the number of less molecules that a cell has would be halved. And in order to check whether this really works, we did the following experiment. We grew cells on glucose, we stained them, yeah, putting these dye molecules onto it. We put them back on glucose, and we're following the cells in here as they were growing with flow cytometry. I was wondering, who is familiar with flow cytometry? Okay, a few. So then I'll probably quickly explain it. It's a very simple device. It's more or less nothing else than a capillary, where cells would go in, would flow through in a manner that there's one cell after the other. Yeah, and then there's a laser that would shine at the cells, and there's a detector here that records fluorescence of individual particles, individual cells. Next to recording fluorescence, there's also a detector measuring the scatter of the light. We can measure the fluorescence of particles, and we can measure the scatter. So we would look, for instance, here, and would see how much light is being scattered to the side. Yeah, this is nothing else than a very simple device with which one can look at individual particles, individual cells. Just as a side note, very complex flow cytometers can even sort. Yeah, and then this is called a fax. So we're depending on what the detector measures, cells go either this way or this way. Yeah, but we don't use this here. We just use the property of detecting fluorescence and this side scatter. Okay, so this is a flow cytometer. This is what we use. So we track the fluorescence of these cells as they would grow here. And this is the result of such a flow cytometric analysis. What you see here on a log scale would be the fluorescence of this dye. Yeah. Just also here, it was a red. So we have red fluorescence here. And here is side scatter. This is the scatter light if you look from here. And what you should see is that this has been a terribly maintained flow cytometer because there's a lot of dirt in it. So all of this is dirt. Yeah. So don't look at this. And the color here, you have to interpret it such that if it's red, then there's lots of cells. And if it's more greenish, then there's less. And blue is less dots. So there's a particular color scale behind. So if you now look at this, directly we put these stained cells in here, and at this we define as time point zero. So what you see is that most cells are very bright here. Yeah, so this is where most cells are. And as time goes by here, what you can see is that this cloud here moved to the left. Yeah, and moved to the left any further. And if you now take the fluorescence here, the median fluorescence of this cloud, plot this on this axis in a log scale here as a function of time, what you can see is that fluorescence, there's a decay of fluorescence, an exponential decay. The rate of this decay here corresponds pretty much to the growth rate that we have determined classically by measuring the optical density as a function of time. Yeah, so what you can see is apparently that this assay, yeah, following this idea here, where with every division the fluorescence would be halved, that this works pretty well. Sorry? Here? This is the fluorescence intensity on the log scale. So that records how much fluorescence each particle has, each cell has. Yeah, so and if it's very much to the right, yeah, then these particles are highly fluorescent, and if it's sort of more on the left, then it's less fluorescent. Okay, so now we could go to the actual experiment that we wanted to do. So we took these cells now from glucose, stained them, put them into acetate, and again performed such flow cytometric analyses. So initially, you again see the cells are very bright, and now as time goes by, so when you look at 10 hours here, what you start to see is that there's now two clouds emerging. One here, that still more or less has the fluorescence of this one here, and another one here. Yeah? And as time further goes by, you see that they are getting more than these are. Now, if I now take this data here and normalize it with a cell count at every different time point, we get data like this. So this is fluorescence intensity in log scale, number of cells here. And initially, all cells were here. Yeah, so this is time point zero. And as time went by, what you start seeing is that there's one part of the population that does not lose fluorescence. Yeah, they stay here. They don't hardly grow in number. And there's other cells that continue to lose fluorescence, continue to move to the left, to continue increase in number. So apparently, and if we take these numbers under these Gaussian distributions here and plot them in the classical cell count versus time plot, which is indicated here by these open circles where you see this lag phase, this apparently what that shows you that there's apparently really two different populations. One population grows normally, and another population that would hardly grow or would not grow. So this is within the resolution of the experiment. So what you can state here, once we shift cells from glucose to acetate, is apparently two distinct growth phenotypes that would occur. No, the fluorescence comes from this dye that we used. Yeah, that's really a fluorescent dye, and we expose this dye to the cells, and then this dye would sort of intercalate into the membrane of the cells. And it would stay there. And it would just sort of dilute out as cells would grow. Yeah? Like I showed here. Hmm? Sorry? Yes, that's the point. Because they don't grow. That is a conclusion, yeah, that we say, apparently there are cells that do that, yeah, that with every division, this cell now has just half as many dye molecules as this one here. So this cell is apparently growing. And if another one that would just stay like this would indicate it's not growing. And this is shown here. Yeah, these cells, they might have made one division, and then they stop growing, and they don't lose fluorescence. And these cells here lost fluorescence and increased in number. Okay, so we can conclude here there's apparently two distinct growth phenotypes that would occur after this shift. Now, every normally trained microbiologist would say, hey, could this just be a mutation? Yeah, that these cells that grew here, that just acquired spontaneously a mutation, so we would have to show that this is not due to genetic differences, but that this is actually a phenotypic difference. But before I go into this, I answer your question. No, acetate comes in by diffusion. This is at least acetate comes in by diffusion. Yes. Okay, so the question is there some mutation that had happened? Yeah? Is it really two phenotypes of the same genotype, or is that two phenotypes, two genotypes? Yeah?
You can select any kind of chromophore as a material in
the... Sorry, can you say?
We can select any kind of chromophore as a fluorescence material in
Sorry, I didn't get the
chromophore.
Chromophore to do what? It
means dye molecule with fluorescence active. Dye molecule, which is resonating structure with fluorescence active.
So, sorry, I don't get the question.
That is what they have used for integrating the cell, a chromophore molecule.
Yes, this is a dye molecule, a fluorescent dye molecule.
Any kind of dye molecule?
No, this was a very specific one that really would be fluorescent. Yeah, so that had, yeah, we could, this is fluorescent. And these fluorescent molecules had the property that they really, really good would stick in the membrane and would stay there. Yeah, this was just an assay, an experimental assay, to sort of allow us to track the growth history of cells. Clear or still confused? Okay, so the point here is we see two different growth phenotypes. And the question is this two different growth phenotypes that the same genotype would show? Or is this eventually two different genotypes that we're seeing here? So for that, we went, this is our whole experimental procedure. So we started from a plate, from an agar plate, where we have individual colonies, and we would re-inoculate them overnight, go into the glucose culture, would stain them, would go into the acetate culture, and then perform this experiment that I've just shown you. And here we waited until we more or less just had growing cells, yeah? So we were, where these cells here had outgrown these few non-growing ones, and then took a sample from this culture, went through a plate again, plated them out so that we have individual cells here, or individual colonies, and went through the whole procedure. And what we saw exactly the same thing again. What does that mean? Or what would we have expected if this behavior would have been due to two different genotypes? What would have been the case if this behavior, this, sorry? The smaller population, the non-growing population, we would not have seen it here. Yeah, because the growing one would have outgrown it, and if it would have been a distinct genotype, if you go through the whole thing again, here we would have just seen growing cells. So this was the evidence that, now that we repeat this, that these two populations, and we can repeat this again, get the same behavior, that this behavior must be due to the same genotype. Yeah? So apparently the two phenotypes that we see are not due to different genotypes. Okay? Well, another question that you might have, is this now specific to when we switch cells to acetate? Or is that something very rare and just happens when we switch them to acetate? Or is that also something that happens when we switch them to other carbon sources? And here this data shows you, when you switch these cells from glucose to other carbon sources, we again get these two populations. Yeah, so it's not specific to acetate. Another question that you have, surely have, is are these non-growing cells actually viable? What is the opposite of non-viable? It's dead, yeah? What kind of a phenotype would a dead cell be? Yeah? So is this a real phenotype, yeah? Or are simply when we confront cells to these carbon sources, would simply part of the cells die, yeah? So in order to check this, what we did is we switched cells from glucose to fumarate in this case, and then this is what we found, total number of cells versus time. So the black dots are the total cell counts as a function of time. The squares are the non-growing cells, and these triangles are the growing cells. And what we did at the time points indicated here with these arrows, is we took samples from this culture, and we plated them out on a plate. And this is an assay that allows us to determine the number of viable cells. So plating out, meaning that on an agar plate, at each spot in this agar plate, you would just have an individual cell. Now you dilute your culture so much that once you spread it out on a surface, that on each visual area, you would have just a single cell. And then you can count how many cells, and then you let these cells grow. They will form colony, then you can see them. So this is a way how one in microbiology would typically determine the number of viable cells in a culture. Yeah? So that is what we did. And we used flow cytometry again to determine the total number of cells in this culture. The total.
The initial cells that you took in glucose.
Yes.
There, everything got, I mean, half. So there was a single colony. The very first, even before this.
So this one here, we just took cells, stained, and put them in here, and then followed their fluorescence. This slide here just shows you that this essay, that the idea of this essay, of this halving of the idea of this halving of fluorescence, that this works. And the evidence for this is that this growth rate, the exponential decay rate of this fluorescence corresponds to the growth rate.
In this case, there was no other
population. Yes, exactly. Because we just switched up from glucose to glucose. They should just continue to. Yes. No. Then this is now a side aspect, and everything rose. But so, did you get the idea of this experiment? So there's some kind of assay that one can do to determine the number of viable cells in a culture, and an assay that can determine the total number of cells in a culture, because this is an assay that just determines the particles, and a dead cell is still a particle. Yeah, would have been. So we determine these two numbers at each of these time points indicated by these arrows, and we're plotting this in this diagram. Yeah, so this information is plotted here, this information is plotted here, and we could see that this all lies on the diagonal. And that means that at all these time points, total number of cells equals the number of viable cells. And the conclusion from that is there is no dead cells. Yeah, so that even this non-growing population here that does not grow here on acetate, they're viable. Yeah? So that, and if they're viable, then this would be a real phenotype. Another question that you might have is, when would now these two subpopulations emerge? When do they come up? When are they built? And for that, and one hypothesis was that they eventually were built on the glucose in the glucose growth phase still, because on glucose, and this is what I told you last 2 days already, is that on glucose, E. coli takes up glucose and produces this acetate. And eventually, it could have been such that there's a second subpopulation present that consumes the acetate that the other cells have produced. Yeah? So here in this glucose growth phase, it could have been that there's already two populations present. The question is now, how do you find out whether this is really the case? Because we would have to look in single cells, and it would have to find a way to see whether they either consume glucose or consume acetate. So this is our challenge. There's lots of cells in this culture here. And how would you find out whether they metabolize this or metabolize this? So we opted for the following experiment. What we did is that we, here in this glucose culture, added 13C labeled acetate. Now, if you think along, now you should, by now you should be able to come up with what we would do in the following. So if this population would be there, they would, of course, also take up this 13C labeled acetate. And then we would need to find, if you now take cells from here, you'd need to find this 13C label incorporated into the biomass. Yeah, so we took cells here, we extracted proteins from this, we used a GC-TOF analysis to determine the 13C labeling patterns in the protein-bound amino acids. Now, the question is, what do you now expect? Now, we look into the amino acids that we got from the proteins of these cells here in the glucose culture. And what would you expect if this second population is not present? No 13C label, yeah? This is what we had hoped for, but things are always not as clear as one would think they are. So this is what we found. What you see here is a rudimentary part of metabolism. Glycolysis up here, TCA cycle up here. These colored boxes are amino acids, and they're with the arrows, they're connected to the respective precursor in metabolism. Yeah, so this amino acid here is synthesized from this compound. These amino acids are synthesized from this compound. Now, if you use a certain color code, the color code is such that all unlabeled compounds that don't carry any 13C label are indicated in yellow. All compounds that are fully labeled are indicated in blue. You probably can already guess of what green would mean. Yeah, green is a mixture of blue and yellow. So this is what we found. So what does that mean? Sorry? This is an all population, yeah? So we take a sample here from the total population. This is something that we cannot do on a single cell level, so this was on a total population.
It can mean two things. A single cell is doing both, or some of the cell in the population is doing one thing and another is doing. Yeah.
Well, in a, yes, we can. You're half right, half wrong. So what it definitely means that acetate is definitely taken up, right? Otherwise, we would not have these green amino acids here. But the fact that this is just yellow up here would also mean that the acetate that comes in here and usually would go this way, that this label doesn't reach these compounds here. And for a cell to fully grow on acetate only, it would have had to be such that the label would have also reached these compounds. So what that tells us is that acetate is being taken up, but there's no gluconeogenesis. And because there's no gluconeogenesis, that means there's no subpopulation present that solely grows on acetate. This is actually the fact that acetate is being taken up even during growth on glucose goes a bit against the textbook, because the textbook says there is something that is called glucose repression, where cells should shut down everything else if glucose is there. But it's probably not the case. So even on glucose, they are taking up this acetate. And this is actually a very good thing and a necessary thing for this whole flux sensing idea to work. Because the flux sensing idea rests on the assumption that all doors are always at least slightly open. Because the cell senses inside, yeah? And this shows us that even on glucose, cells take a bit of acetate. So once glucose is gone, acetate can flush in and being sensed. The flushing in can be sensed. Okay, so apparently this subpopulation is not there on glucose. So it must emerge at the time point of the carbon source switch. So the type of switching behavior that we think is going on, well, there's three types of switching behaviors that we think could in principle think about three types of switching behaviors. This one here, responsive switching, would be the very classical switching as every microbiologist would have thought until a few years ago, that cells of a population here would have a certain adaptation state, a certain phenotype before the environmental change, and now this dotted line would indicate the environmental change, and then these cells would slowly start to depart and would adapt themselves, and once they're fully adapted, then they would start to grow in number. Yeah, so this is how microbiologists would typically see cells to adapt between different conditions. Well, a few years back, it was also proposed that there's another strategy that cells could follow, and this would be the stochastic switching strategy, where already in one environment here, in this glucose environment, there could be a second population present. Yeah, that is already prepared for a new environment. And then once this new environment comes, they would take over. Yeah, that's something that people have referred to bed hatching, where this population as a whole would hatch the bed that there's acetate, that soon acetate will come. But with this experiment I showed you in the previous slide, we sort of can exclude this one here as well. So what we think is happening is probably what could be best described with responsive diversification. Yeah, so there is one unimodal population present, unimodal but heterogeneous, where only some parts of these cells, of this population, would sort of be able to make this transition to the new environment. And then some other cells of this population that, in the variation of this population, are not able to make it and would sort of would remain non-growing in the next environment. We think this scenario, this model here, describes best what we're seeing here. Okay, so we think that this is what we see here. Well, now you probably ask yourself, what is now actually the fraction of the cells that would decide to grow? What is the number of cells that would go this path here? And in order to find this out, we went back to this data here, which I showed you before, and fitted a mathematical model that consisted of two Gaussian distributions and also an equation that described the growth rate of the growing population with just an exponential function. And this model, you know, fitted to this dynamic data here. Yeah, so we're, on the one hand side, this Gaussian distribution had to be fitted, and the development of this Gaussian distribution here had to be an exponential. The number of cells under these Gaussian distribution had to follow an exponential function over time. So with fitting this model to this data, of course, we could now get the growth rate, estimate the growth rate of the growing population. But we also could use it to estimate the fraction of adapting cells. And the fraction of adapting cells we got from this equation here, where this here is the total number of cells at time point zero. So the number of cells that we use to inoculate this new culture. And this is the number of cells under this curve here at time point zero. This up here is the number of growing cells at time point x. So this would be, for instance, the number of cells under this curve here. And we divide this number by 2 to the power of number of divisions. And the number of divisions we estimate from time point zero, from the fluorescence of time point zero, and estimate how often have these cells under this curve here, how often have they halved their fluorescence. Yeah, so we compare the fluorescence, the median fluorescence of these cells here with the median of the fluorescence at time point zero, and then we estimate how often has this half been halved. Yeah? And from the estimation of how often has been halved, we can sort of calculate back how many divisions these cells had undergone. Yes? Yes. So this goes back to the question that was asked before. Yeah, if you would now have a bimodal population, you were asking whether this could also go back to unimodal. Effectively, in the experiment, it is such that this population here, this is the one that grows. And this keeps on growing, keeps on growing, keeps on growing. So at some point, although these cells will still be there, you won't see them anymore. Yeah, because they're just outnumbered. Effectively, yes. Well, the why we've.
I could think of a scenario where there's a group of cells that are just more responsive to the environment, right? And there are two groups. So there's a group that's responsive, there's a group that's not, which is a stochastic switch, right? And so you get, and just with that underlying system, you'll end up with something that is. Looks very much like responsive diversification.
Yes, the point is a bit that, of course, for in order to get this diversification, the cells of this population here need to be diverse. Yeah, they need to have different phenotypes, whatever this phenotype would be. Yeah. In a way, you could, and I'll come back to this later. You could look at this, if you go on a highway, yeah, say with two lanes, and there's an exit on the right. Yeah? On this highway, you as a driver are sometimes on the left lane, sometimes on the right lane, but you're still going in this direction. So you have the same phenotype because you go in this direction. But there is stochastic variation, you being on the left lane and you being on the right lane. But once you're on the right lane, and if the exit is on the right, you're probably more prone to be flexible to make the to get this exit. And this is how you have to look at this one here. There is variability between these cells, although these cells are all growing in glucose, but they're probably not all growing equally fast and therefore being more prone to make the exit or not. But the important thing is, and that's why we coined this term, is that here you would not, at least not macroscopically, see the different phenotypes. Yeah, there's probably all the stochastic variation of the same phenotype. Yeah, they're all growing on glucose. So the actual diversification just happens at a distinct event. And the distinct event on this highway example is, oh, the exit was there. Shit, I missed it. Yeah. And which is, I think, something different than this one here, where these ones have already before the shift a distinctly different phenotype. No, but still.
The phenotype that you're asking, right? So I could say that the phenotype that is stochastically switching is this responsiveness. This lanes, for example, that you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
right? And so that is a stochastic switch, and the you're measuring a phenotype that's a couple of levels down.
Yes, no, of course, if you would look at every individual cell in a culture, every single cell would be different. Yeah, if you could count all molecules and all cells, there would be not two cells that would be exactly the same. So the question is, what would we define as a phenotype? And I think, probably from a practical point of view, here where people have looked at stochastic switching, then it was really clear that these cells had different phenotypes. Here, I think it's probably less clear that these cells have different phenotypes, just as it's less clear that I'm now on the right lane or the left lane. Yeah. But you're right. One could see this also graded here between these two things, but I still think there's value of calling this slightly different to not confuse it with this. Okay, is this clear? How we now? Yes. The stochastic switching we ruled out by the fact that we did not find cells. Not find acetate growing cells on glucose. And this was done on all cells, yeah, but if there would have been cells that grew on acetate, while cells were on glucose, then these amino acids would have also been green.
The shade of green will depend on how many sections they
only. Yes. So of course, this is an experimental technique that has certain kind of limits of resolution. But as you will see in my next slide, when we determine the number of cells that actually go for the growing phenotype and the non-growing phenotype, you will see that this number would have been big enough to be able to be uncovered here.
For some, you know, for part of their activities, but some critical amino acids are not being manufactured from acetate.
Exactly.
But they are uptaking acetate, yes, to augment whatever they're getting from glucose or whatever it is. You know, so there is some acetate in them.
Yes, that's fully correct. And again, this is important for this flux sensing to work. Important here was just that there was no, that we did not see any green here. And if we would have seen green here, then this would have indicated there's already a subpopulation present that would grow an acetate. And if these would have been green here, this would have indicated that we have had this scenario here.
But to consume acetate, you don't have to be a different phenotype. I mean, you have to make other things because if acetate comes in by
But it's being used. It not just comes in, but it's being metabolized, yeah, because it ends up in these amino acids. Let me go, and I guess it will become clear once I move on. So this thing here allowed us now to determine the growth rate of the growing population and a fraction of cells that decide to adapt. And we call this alpha, and this alpha will follow us until the end of the talk.
So this alpha, is it a function of time, or is it a constant?
The way we have defined it here is actually, this equation defines it at time point zero. At time point zero, a number of cells decides to go this way, and a number of cells decides to go this way. So this is what this alpha does. But if you would follow the fraction of growing versus non-growing cells over time, this will, of course, change, because the growing ones will outgrow the non-growing ones. But as it is defined here, it's at time point zero how many cells decide to go for the growing phenotype. So the experiment that we now do is we take these cells, get them from glucose, stain them, put them into acetate. And we now carry out a number of experiments where we throw them into an acetate environment, where there's different acetate concentration. Yeah? So this is the experiment that we now do. And we first determine the growth rate of the growing population as a function of the acetate concentration in the new environment. What we see here, what we find here, is something that is also known from the textbook. That's the monokinetic. The monokinetic says that the growth rate of cells can be sort of a function of the concentration of the nutrient. And it has this Michaelis-Menten type shape. So this is all that was known, and this is sort of all clear. What we also found is that when we now looked at this adapting fraction alpha, we found that this fraction alpha is also dependent on the acetate concentration. And if you look at this, at low acetate concentration, it's as little as 10% of the cells that start to adapt. If you increase the acetate concentration, it can go up to 60% of cells adapting. By just changing the concentration of the extracellular nutrient, of the nutrient. By the way, this finding here probably also rules out the stochastic switching, because all these cells have been the same cells on glucose, and we now just inoculate different acetate cultures, and we get a completely different response.
Clarification. There was one experiment in which you have glucose, mm-hmm, and then you wash it off,
yes,
and then put acetate.
Yes.
And there was another experiment that you talked about in which you had both glucose and acetate simultaneously.
Yes.
Now, which experiment is this one?
This one is, we have glucose here, and now we go into multiple cultures which have different acetate concentrations. So high ones
washed off.
And washing was here. Washing and staining. So we took these cells, we washed them and stained them. You have staining meaning putting the adding this fluorescent dye. And then putting them in acetate culture in cultures where there was, and now the size of the, these letters would indicate high concentrations, low concentrations. And what this diagram shows here, that at low acetate concentrations, you have low alpha. So here, very little cells start to grow on acetate. Here, many cells start to grow on acetate. Although, they came from the same glucose culture. Well, this is alpha at time zero. So meaning that... the point is that those cells that opt for the non-growing phenotype will stay with this. They will never start to grow. So this is this one here tells us how many cells go for the growing phenotype, and one minus this is the cells that go for the non-growing phenotype. Yes. Yes. Yeah, so if it would happen stochastic switching, yeah, then the idea would be that the cells that would go for acetate, yeah, would already be there before. So then we would have expected some kind of straight line here. But by the fact that we can modulate this response here through the acetate concentration that we use here, would also argue against stochastic switching. Okay, so what we will do in the last 37 minutes, I'll show you what is now the molecular mechanism that underlies this responsive diversification. Okay? Yes?
Exactly the same. You know, all the curves are almost exactly the same. And usually in systems biology, that's called a stochastic switch, right? It's the lack of repressor.
If you would do this experiment, if you switch.
We did do all these experiments from you know, glucose to lactose, and this is exactly the phenomenon.
What they are seeing, as far as I recall, is that they would see different lag phases, but in this case, all cells at some point would start to grow. Yeah, the point is probably that the glucose to lactose switch is that the two attractors are much closer together. So where inherent stochasticity, even if you go for one attractor, the inherent stochasticity is still there, can make you stochastically switching to the other one.
Right, but the phenomenology looks the same.
The phenomenology looks the same, but what is the case here is that these cells that here decide to go for the non-growing phenotype, it seems that the attractors are so far apart that even inherent stochasticity in both states cannot cells to hop from one to the other anymore. And that is probably a significant difference to the laxes. Okay, so what is the molecular phenotype? For that, I'll show you again the data that I've just shown you. I showed you that the alpha is acetate concentration dependent. Yeah, this one here. I also showed you that the acetate concentration influences the growth rate. This was this diagram. And if the acetate concentration influences the growth rate, wouldn't that not mean that the acetate concentration also influences the carbon flux in a cell? Yeah? The growth rate is nothing else than a flux. Would you agree with this conclusion? Yeah? If by modulating the acetate concentration, we can influence the growth rate, then if we can influence the growth rate by the acetate concentration, we can probably also influence flux. You're probably seeing where I'm heading at. If this is acetate concentration, if acetate concentration influences flux, could it not be that carbon flux would make the decision on what kind of alpha you would get? Now, question is, how could we now really test this, whether really carbon influx is decisive? How could one experimentally test this? Well, for this, you know, switched cells from glucose to fumarate, which is just another carbon source where we saw this responsive diversification. And fumarate is a carbon source that is being transported into the cell with a transporter. Acetate, as I explained earlier, is just diffusing into cells. So what if you now switch these cells to a carbon source that is transported into cells with a transporter? Could we now not tinker around with the abundance of this transporter and sort of controlling this? Yeah, so if you would express this transport on a higher level, there would be more fumarate coming in. And if indeed carbon influx rate is decisive for this, then we should be able to, just by modulating the abundance of a transporter, we should be able to modulate this. Do you get the logic? Okay, let's do this experiment. Fumarate is transported into with this transporter here, and we modulate the abundance of this transporter by expressing it from an IPGG-inducible plasmid. We just dial in the amount of this transporter. We perform these switch experiments, determine alpha. So that is what we do. Again, we switch up from glucose to stain and fumarate, and here's the result that we get. So here you see the level of the inducer on glucose. Yeah, different inducer levels. Here you see the inducer concentration on fumarate, and each of these crosses here is an individual experiment. It's been an individual experiment where we determined alpha. So what is plotted here is this alpha. And what you can see is if you don't induce this transporter, neither on glucose nor on fumarate, then it's about 5 in 1,000 cells that start to adapt. If we induce it on both cases, we get 50% adapting. Yeah? And the only thing that we did is we tinkered around with the abundance of a transporter. And I would argue if you tinker around with the abundance of a transporter, the only thing that we did is probably we dialed in the rate of carbon influx. Okay? So if carbon influx, this experiment is supposed to show you that carbon influx rate is decisive. And now how could this translate now into different alphas? For that, you had listened to me carefully yesterday, where I showed you that E. coli can actually measure metabolic flux. Is there a question? Yeah.
When you do an inducer experiment, isn't it the same as what you're observing, that when you're changing from one media to the other, you'll have two subpopulations? Even the response to the inducer could have subpopulations.
You would be arguing that that this inducing this would you're arguing that this would give heterogeneity. Okay, eventually that could be the case, but if in a way, what this experiment where we haven't induced anything, I argue that with changing the acetate concentration in the medium, yeah, we more or less already change the influx, yeah, influx rate, because just gradients are higher, and then there's more flowing in. So I would take both experiments together. Yeah, I see your concern that this could happen here. but I would take, let's put it as a hypothesis, yeah, that it is still a hypothesis that flux is being decisive. And if flux is decisive, yeah, then we would need flux sensing, yeah, to pick this up. I told you about this flux sensor yesterday. So what you can now do as a next step to prove the pudding is to tinker around with this flux sensor and see whether we get a difference in alpha. So the question was whether there's a way to modulate acetate flux. Yeah, the question is always, what is flux determining? Yeah, it's some enzyme needs to be limiting. So we could have now, and it must not be the first acetate metabolism enzyme. It could also have been the second or the third or whatever. So we could have gone and also dialed in all these enzymes. So that, but it was easier for us to just say, let's go for fumarate, where normally, if you don't do anything, very few cells would start to grow. So we had a very low level from which we could start increasing the flux by potentially increasing the flux by increasing the transporter abundance. It was just experimental convenience where we did this with fumarate.
In the previous task there.
This one here, yeah.
So, before you're doing the washing, you have added IPTG, which has increased the carbon flux.
The abundance of the transporter protein.
Transporter protein for what?
For fumarate in this case, yeah? So. More or less, we've done that. We had more of the transporter proteins that would get us fumarate in. That was the idea of the experiment. More IPTG would mean more of these, the transporter proteins that would get fumarate in.
Mm-hmm. Then you have added IPTG before and after. Is that right?
Before or after, or only before and only after, or only after. Right. So if you're on this line here, then we have just added it before. On this line, only after, and on this line, everything is between different combinations. Yeah, so the fact that indeed here we're just adding it after, and what you can see, you can hardly change it afterwards. Yeah, so the expression of a protein is something that takes, I don't know, half an hour or so. The fact that we hardly can change the alpha when we induce it after means that the decision is really made very close to the switch. It's not something that is made over a longer period of time. Okay, so with this experiment, it had suggested that carbon flux could be decisive. This is what I mentioned yesterday. And here we thought maybe it's one of these flux sensors that plays a role. So what we try to do next is that we try to say, hey, now let's perturb this potential flux sensor and see what's happening. So first we focused on this transcription factor C or A. And what we did here is that we modulated the concentration of this transcription factor by, again, inducing it from a plasmid. We performed the substrate switch experiments and determined the growth rate, the growing population, and alpha. And what you can see in this diagram is the following. So here on this axis would be the copy numbers of this transcription factor. The dark gray bars would belong to this axis, and the light gray bar belongs to this axis. So what you can see first is that despite the fact that we modulate here the abundance of this copy number, the growth rate doesn't really change of the growing cells. But if there's none of this transcription factor, cells cannot grow on acetate. But what you also can see is if you lower, so this is the wild type copy number here, if you lower the copy number here, what you can see is that then less cells are able to switch. This would indicate that indeed this transcription factor is important for the switching behavior, but not important for the growth rate. But this is, so that would suggest that there's a connection between here. Well, the other thing is that I told you yesterday is that it's this metabolite that would repress the activity of this transcription factor. So in the next step, we try to perturb here to see whether we get a response here. So how would you now perturb a metabolite? Yeah. Overexpressing is a bit difficult. It does not work. So how can you perturb a metabolite? You could perturb an enzyme that sort of produces or consumes this metabolite. That's exactly what we did. So if you see here a part of a metabolic pathway, from acetate we go to fructose bisphosphate in multiple steps. And then here's the consuming enzyme. So here we overexpressed the enzyme that consumes that. So if it's overexpressing this, this would be lower, then this activity would be higher. And what you can see, indeed, if we overexpress this, so this would be high IPGG, this would be low IPGG, indeed get more cells to switch than the wild type here. Yeah? We overexpress this enzyme, which would correspond to this bar. This would be non-overexpressed. And what you can see is there's much more cells able to adapt by just overexpressing a metabolic protein, an enzyme. If you do a perturbation in the other direction, we take an inhibitor here that would inhibit this enzyme. If we inhibit this, we get more of this. We get more less activity of this. And this is what you can see. With increased inhibitor concentration, well, the alpha drops dramatically. Yeah, by just inhibiting, again, an enzyme that would presumably change the concentration of this metabolite. So here's probably a good point to make a quick summary, recap. So with a modulated acetate concentration or with a modulated transporter for fumarate uptake, we've probably modulated the metabolic fluxes. With modulated metabolic fluxes, we probably modulate this level of this metabolite. And this metabolite would do something here. Yeah. So this is what I've showed you so far. But the question is now, how would we get bistability? Because this is what you're looking for, right? And to remind you again, this is what we need to get bistability. Molecular noise is something that we get for free. Cells have to live with that. So that's nothing that we would have to worry about. But how would we get a positive feedback here? And the way we would get this is in this particular way. And this transcription factor turns out to be responsible, actually, for cranking up the flux of alternative carbon sources. So if you look at, don't look at this yet, first on this. So this is, again, a metabolic chart. Acetate comes in here, goes through the TCA cycle, all the way up here, gluconeogenic pathway. And all these green enzymes, and there's even more, I should update this figure. All these green enzymes are sort of activated by this transcription factor. So what you can see, the more this is active, the higher the abundance of these enzymes will be. And if they're more abundant, there's probably more flux. And then here we would get the positive feedback. OK? So until this point, it's all wishful thinking, sort of inferred from things that we had seen. And now in the next step, we wanted to really test this. And for that, we implemented a small model, a small ODE type model. And the topology was just this one here. And I'll quickly walk you through this topology. So this would be a metabolic pathway here, which would just have, oh, there's a question before I go into this.
Yeah. Actually, in that graph, there is repression as well as induction on the second step after acetate in the Krebs cycle.
This one here.
Yeah, yeah. So what is it?
Can we talk about this in a break? Or you look at a supplementary file of the paper. We very extensively discussed this. Why? And there's also red arrows here. It turns out that this even, at least these ones even help for the process to happen. But if I would go into this, I would completely lose the rest of the audience.
Sure, sure.
Let me walk you through this graph here, through this topology. So this is a metabolic pathway, just two enzymes. One super enzyme E that would translate a carbon source into the level of this metabolite. And this metabolite is then consumed with this enzyme here. Yeah, so a metabolic pathway with just two enzymes. Now this FVP would repress this CRA. The CRA would be responsible for expressing this E enzyme here. Yeah. And at this moment we don't look at this, but now I would like you walk you through this. So if there's acetate concentration is high, or if the abundance of this transporter, of this fumarate transporter is high, then you would probably agree that we get a high flux. Okay? So this would be a lot of this, high flux would be a plus sign. Now, what is the connection between flux and FVP? Yeah, if the flux is high, we could eventually assume that FVP is high. So also a plus. If FVP, and this is a minus, this is a plus again. So if you have high cryo activity, we have lots of E. And if you have lots of E, we have high flux. Has anybody counted how many minus signs did we have? One minus. So this would be a negative feedback. But damn, we're looking for a positive feedback. And this is why this feed-forward activation is here. So there is a feed-forward activation where flux, and the flux is high, this metabolite is high, and this metabolite feed-forward activates this enzyme here. So what happens if flux is high, this is highly active, and then this is low. So you would get a minus from here to here. So I'll walk you through again. Plus, minus, plus here. So you now have two minuses. So this feed-forward activation, what that actually does, it translates a negative feedback into a positive feedback. If now taken this topology and have implemented this in equations, looks like this. And with these equations, we performed a bifurcation analysis. And this gave us this bifurcation diagram, which more or less asks or shows us that indeed there could be two stable metabolic fluxes through this pathway, one at a very low level here and one at a very high level here. These are stable metabolic fluxes through this pathway. And these stable metabolic fluxes are separated by this metastable one, a watershed. And these stable metabolic fluxes represent two attractors. So a cell that, when confronted with the environmental change, sort of sitting above the watershed is being attracted to the high state. Once it's sitting below this watershed, it's being attracted to the low state. Yeah, so this is what apparently this topology that I showed you on this slide could accomplish.
Any saddle point in bifurcation?
Sorry?
Any saddle point? Saddle point in bifurcation?
You're referring to this one here, or? Well, all of these points, this would be the metastable point here, which is unstable. Yeah, this is unstable. Yeah, so these would be the stable states here, the stable attractors, and this is the metastable one. So, and these arrows here point you towards the attractors. because these are, a cell could not sit here because it's simply not stable. So if you now take this and compare this with our experimental data, then this is very consistent. So if we assume that this would be a histogram of cells, yeah, number of cells, and on this axis there would be the metabolic fluxes that they could generate when confronted with the environmental change. So there's some cells that could only generate low fluxes, some cells that could generate high gluconeogenic fluxes. So you would take this population of cells that is now unimodal but heterogeneous, going back to our earlier discussion that we had, and we switch these cells to this acetate concentration down here. So you would go up here to this watershed, go over here. So it would now only be these few cells that would be attracted to this high state. And these cells would be attracted to this low state. If we perform a different experiment, we would switch these cells to a higher acetate concentration. Yeah, higher acetate concentration. What you see is that now these cells would be able to be attracted to the high state. And these cells would be attracted to the low state. Yeah? So it would be very much consistent with what we had seen experimentally. But in order to really show whether this is now really the true mechanism, we took the model and performed predictions with this model of what would happen. And one of the predictions that we'd made is that we asked what would happen if we reduce the maximal rate of expression of this enzyme here. And for that, for these predictions, we got different bifurcation diagrams that are shown here. So these arrows here point into the direction of the reducing this expression rate of this enzyme here. So what you can see in these altered bifurcation diagrams is the following. Well, one thing that you can see is that this stable state here, this high stable state, is basically unaltered. Yeah, maybe a slightly, little tiny bit, but it's more or less up here. And this is the flux, the metabolic flux through this pathway. And if the metabolic flux of this pathway is not altered, wouldn't that imply that the growth rate of the growing cells should be more or less untouched? Right? If the flux through this pathway, through this core metabolic pathway, is not changed, yeah, why should the growth rate of these cells change? But the other thing that is that the other change that is more dramatic is here that this watershed is lifted up. Because this watershed is lifted up, I guess it should be much more difficult for cells to happen to sit above the watershed, and therefore we should expect a significantly reduced growing population fraction, a significantly lowered alpha. Now, the question is how we can test this, and here I have to remind you again, all what we have lumped together into the super enzyme E here is everything from acetate through the TCA cycle up to fructose-based phosphate. Yeah, so we had lumped everything together. And it turns out that E. coli has a number of isoenzymes here, or parallel pathways, metabolic pathways, in what we had lumped together in this enzyme E here. So what you could go and do, the type of perturbation that we could go and do, is that we either knock out parallel pathways or isoenzymes. This is very simple perturbations, and then we could go and test the alpha, determine the alpha. And of course, this is what we did, and this is what we got from this experiment. So you see here the population fraction alpha, you see here the growth rate of the growing population, and the wild type is up here. And all these other things are these mutants that either lacked isoenzymes or parallel pathways. And what can you see? Well, first, if you look at the gray bar, we've drawn this in order to help you seeing the right thing. Well, what you can see is that all these mutants have more or less the same growth rate as the wild type, which corresponds to this one here. What we also can see is that some of these mutants have extreme alpha phenotypes. You know, so this one here is 1 in 100,000 cells. Only 1 in 100,000 cells is able to grow, to start growing an acetate. In terms of lag phase, that corresponds to a lag phase of 80 hours. Now, for 80 hours, you don't see any growth at all. and then only after 80 hours they would start growing, or you would only see seeing cells growing. So that suggests that and this is really consistent with this prediction here, that this seems to be the right mechanism. Something else that if you look at this mechanism here, is that if there is a high acetate concentration, then the flux is high, then FEP should be low. And what I also told you, if flux is high, then FEP would be high in order to activate this forward expression. So we now did as the next experiment, we performed some metabolomics experiment, where we shifted cells to either a very low concentration of acetate, making a low flux, or a high concentration of acetate, making high flux, and looking at the levels of these two metabolites. And for that, we used this metabolomics technique that I showed you on Monday. Here is the data for that. So what you see here is, of course, metabolomics can only be done on the population level. So you see population averaged FVP levels. And here at low acetate concentration, you see that FVP is indeed higher than when we switch to high acetate concentration. And with phosphoenolpyruvate, it's completely the opposite, the other way around. So that also suggests that this topology is indeed the right one. Something else that the model had predicted was that if we would start with an initially high activity of CRA, then also more cells should be able to switch, because then they get this feedback. It's easier for them to get the positive feedback going. So next, we performed an experiment where we changed the initial activity here. And the way we did that is that we grew cells and glucose-limited chemostat cultures. So then we got different growth rates, and it turns out that at different growth rates on glucose, you would get different activity of this transcription factor. And if you have different activity of this transcription factor, what you can see here is we can get completely different alphas. And in terms of lag phase, this really looks like this here. You can really see by just controlling the growth rate on glucose, we can get tremendously different lag phases here when we switch these cells. Okay, so that's probably a good moment to look at what this circuit is actually now doing globally. So what we think what it's doing is that it's doing performance-based selection. So make only those cells that are most competent for gluconeogenic carbon uptake will be assigned to the growing phenotype and all others are turned off. So given the fact that there's stochasticity in protein expression everywhere, this makes that not every single cell is equally well equipped to generate high enough gluconeogenic flux. This flux is being measured by this circuit and used to either assign the cells to the growing phenotype or to the non-growing phenotype. So with that, and this is just to show you again that here's an experiment where we had cells grown on different glucose chemostat cultures, switched them to fumarate, and what you can see is that these lag phases that we observe are nothing else than different fractions of cells that would start to adapt. Okay, here's again this highway example. So with the experiment that I just showed you, what I probably should stress, if you drive on a highway in Europe, it's such that on the left lane, you can only pass cars on the left lane. So the left lane is the fast one, the right one is the slow one. Yeah? So more or less, we were stochastically changing here. And if we're here, you probably have a harder time making a suddenly occurring exit. If you're on this lane, you're probably more prone to make it to an exit. So what I've just shown you with this experiment where we controlled the growth rate on glucose, what we more or less did, we put up speed limits here. So that also cars on the left lane the chance is higher that they also will make the exit. In a way, you can also look at this in such a way that you could choose as a cell, you could choose to go very fast. Yeah, then you're here. And this is very good. Yeah, you can, if your environment persists, if you go straight here, this is very good. It's probably the best strategy that you could follow. But you're probably less flexible once there's something coming up, yeah? Once where you have to very respond very rapidly. And I think this is exactly what we see here in E. coli, that this responsive diversification that we see here is that if cells are growing very fast on glucose, and they now all of the sudden would have to switch to a gluconeogenic carbon source, so those cells that have been very good on glucose, they just won't make it. They would not be able to master this adaptation. And only cells that are very slowly, they can do it. With that, I'd like to conclude. What I showed you is that E. coli splits into two phenotypic populations upon a change from a glycolytic to gluconeogenic carbon source. And I have to add that this is something that you can also find with other nutrient shifts that you can confront E. coli with. You can also find this with other organisms. A number of colleagues have found this similar things to happen in other organisms. What was here key for success was really the combination of single cell analysis with mathematical modeling. And I have to say, the story was, of course, did not go as I've presented here. What was still unbelievable for me to believe is that the first thing that we had was this model. It was an extremely gifted student who sort of came up with intense system type thinking, that he came up with a model. And all the experiments that I now showed you in my today's story as being, first we did this experiment and then we learned this system. No, it was completely the other way around. We first had the system and added all these experiments later to prove or to validate. But maybe the last conclusion here would be that it's, I guess, again, another example where a phenotype is not only determined by its genotype, history, environment, but also randomness. And it's randomness that is even here in the most core of metabolism that this plays a role. And what I think I probably also should add is that this feedback, this positive feedback mechanism that leads to this diversification has one element in there. And this is element of flux sensing, yeah, where the decision is being made on the level of flux that cells have. Okay, with that I would I stop and leave some time for questions.
Which have altered alpha. And if you do a flux and a flow cytometry on them, you only observe a unimodal population now?
When we do these mutants that had the changed alphas, these ones.
Yeah, delta A, C, and B. Does it have a unimodal?
It initially, it looks like unimodal. It looks like there's only non-growing ones. But if you wait long enough, there's just this very few, it's this 1 in 100,000 that at some point will start to grow. So at some, you have to wait very long, but then you see the bimodality again.
Other factors start.
No, it's still the same thing, but it's just that this one here has apparently such a reduced E expression rate that it's so few cells that would be able to start to grow. So for a long term, you just see if it would go to, no, if you go to the fluorescence data, do I have it somewhere here? No, I don't have it here anymore. If you would, for a long term, you would just see cells that would stay bright. Because most of the cells would not grow. And only after a very long time, the second population would emerge that would increase in number and would continue to decrease in fluorescence. But there's two populations. But it's just very extreme, yeah, the proportion between those two.
Experiments, you were using an IPTG-based inducible system to upregulate the production of the transporter. But what is the basal level of transporters of other sugars otherwise in cells that are growing on a different sugar to begin with?
Sorry, I'm confused because you're asking for sugar transporters.
Yeah. So suppose you are switching the carbon source and you have cells growing on glucose. What is the basal level of expression of transporters that transport some other kind of carbon source?
So I think a general pattern that we can see, and I think this would probably be a general pattern of the architecture that underlies regulation of metabolism, is that my view on this is that the more cells sense that their rate of glycolysis is low, the more they would start upregulating transport systems for alternative carbon sources, enzymes to metabolize more alternative carbon sources. And when they're very good, yeah, when the glycolytic flux is very high, yeah, they go here, they measure their speed, oh, it's going very well, yeah. Why should they prepare? Because they think everything is good, is fine, yeah. And it's really that on the core of this is already the flux sensing on glucose, because those cells that are able to make the acid, that are able to switch to the acetate, are those that have been slow on glucose. Those that are on this lane. So it's really, we initially talked about the differences here. Yeah? Is these now different phenotypes? Yeah, and I would say this is what is important here, if I would have to describe a phenotype in one dimension here, as I plotted here, I would say these cells are different in their rate of glycolysis on glucose. Because if they're very fast, they won't make it. But if they're very slow on glucose, they have learned, oh, I'm slow on glucose, so I'd rather prepare for opening up the doors, the pathways for alternative carbon sources, and that allows them to make it. Did I answer your question?
But how many such doors can you open at once?
Well, this is, I think, a general, it's something that is known as glucose repression, yeah? So the idea is still that once there's glucose, so this is the old idea, once there's glucose, then they would close all other doors. And the old idea was once the glucose is gone, they open the other doors. But I think we have to rather look at it like this, that it's not the absence or presence of glucose, but it's the rate with which glucose is being metabolized. And then you make a difference. If you metabolize glucose very quickly, you think, oh, this is a very good condition. I don't have to worry about the future. Yeah? And then you keep your other doors more or less closed. But if you see, oh, my glucose metabolism is not going so well, oh, this probably indicates that my glucose will soon be gone, yeah? Then you sort of prepare. And that's exactly, again, this thing here. So it's a trade-off between, yeah. You could also call this a graded bet hedging, yeah? That if you're here, you don't worry about being flexible. Yes, so I would say it's a greater thing. Yeah, the higher your glycolytic flux, the less you worry about adapting. And if it's low, then you think about the future.
You know, if one sort of compares it to stochastic switching, then this is different from stochastic switching in that it's more tunable, basically, right? It's something that is, that's more easily tuned by what's going on, basically. And therefore it's more flexible, in some sense.
Well, here I would say it's like when you go on a highway, you still go in this direction, but you being here or here is something that is stochastic. And now you could say once you're here, then you're gonna make it. Once you're here, you were not going to make this exit. Is this now stochastic switching that was done on purpose? Yeah, you being here or here? I would say no. This is probably just the inherent stochasticity in the working of cells, whether they, in one moment, maybe growing very fast on glucose, yeah, being here, and then they would not be so well equipped to make this, versus on the in the next moment, you're here, and then you're better off. I think I still would like to keep this distinction between responsive diversification and stochastic switching, where stochastic switching is really, I would say, a completely different phenotype, where you more or less would sort of already hear that these two phenotypes would be really very different. Yeah, so because I think stochastic switching is, you would need to have a circuitry that already puts you on the other attractor before. Here, I would say this is still the same. But theoretically, yeah, these two things are the same. But I think, at least from a conceptual point of view, I think it's easier if one would keep them apart.
In this case, than it is in the stochastic switching case, whereas it's sort of more fixed in that case.
No, here it's really such that once a cell has adopted attract is either here or here, the inherent stochasticity that is of course still there. We have never seen a cell going from here to here, and never seen a cell going from here to here. So this means that these two attractors are probably completely different. What I actually showed you, just the mechanism that attracts cells here, we still don't have a good idea. We also think that there's even a positive feedback that fixes this attractor here. We're currently working on this, but this is still a bit too early. So I really think that in this case here, and this distinguishes, I think, that the condition between the glucose, the lactose shift, where these two attractors are probably very close, very much closer. So when you just wait long enough, all of them that initially would not grow would at some point stochastically switch to the other one here. But here, if we go for this highway example, yeah, once you're here, you cannot simply not hop back. So that's why we call it this diversification. And here, because these two attractors are so far apart, it's really a diversification that happens at this very moment here. There were more questions. Yeah. Well, in a way we did, yeah, but by going for this fumarate transporter, we played around. By playing around with the transcription factor that was involved, we did, yeah. So
no further questions. Let's